Hello there, Saints of God. It's me, Brother Henry. I'm in Whittier again on Philadelphia Street, going down to Greenleaf and do some street preaching, street corner preaching. So let's see how this goes. There's a couple of intersections I have marked out. So let's check it out. Trying to see how I can position this camera utilizing my Bible. A little bit of a difficult task, but I'll figure out something. I think that'll work. Come out today to share God's holy word with all of you people in Whittier. Come out from the South Bay to preach God's word to you, to edify you. Those that are lost and dead in their trespasses can know Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. And I do this on a regular basis, because I have a concern and a regard for the lost. I don't want to see my neighbor die in their sins and burn in an unquenchable fire in hell. I don't want that for my neighbor. So I come out and I share the gospel with people. So I've been contemplating where to read during the course of the day and last night, and I had decided to read from Paul's letter to the Romans, to the Roman church, in chapter 3 and in chapter 7. There are a lot of people that I give gospel tracts out to that disregard them and reject them, and they say, I'm good, or I'm okay. And each time they do that and reject God's word, I know that they're not. I even see people that call themselves Christians that say, no thank you, I'm already saved. Some reason I don't believe them. But let God be true and every man a liar, it says. Saying that you're good is self-righteous. The only way that you can be righteous or in right standing with God is through Jesus Christ. The only way is to repent of your sins and to be born again. This happened to me more than 10 years ago. Happened to be in my mom's bathtub. You can be in a number of different places. That's where I happen to be when God rescued my soul from where I was destined to hell. And I broke down. God showed me my heart, how He saw it, and let me see it. And I was appalled at the monster that I was. I was hateful. I was blasphemous. I cursed like a sailor. I did all kinds of evil things, lying and taking things that weren't mine. But God changed me. He changed me into a new creation. And I've never been the same since. This is over 10 years ago. As soon as He saved me, I hit the streets and I couldn't keep my mouth shut. I had to tell other people. I went to churches and I saw hypocrites and was sort of let down by that. I wanted to talk about God with other people in the Bible, and the religious people in the church wanted to talk about everything else. So I said to myself, you know, I've had enough of this, going to church. This is not for me. Church never did anything for me. In fact, when I was in the church, I was still sinning, having sex out of marriage, drinking, smoking, whatever it was. I don't think I was drinking, I was smoking. And I still was under the bondage of sin. But I wasn't anywhere near a church when I got saved. I had read the Bible, but it didn't make any difference to me. I thought I knew it. I thought I was saved. Boy, I was wrong. I was lost as the day is long. But what made sense to me after reading the Bible was that after I got saved, it all made sense. I was reading about the saints of God and their conversions, and I was like, this is the same thing that happened to me. Everything clicked, and I wanted to know more about God, and I had a reverence for God. I had a fear for God. That's what fearing God means, to have utmost reverence for the Lord, to love Him so much that you don't want to sin against Him. Well, it's only through the power of Christ that you can be reconciled back to God, that you can have the power over sin. A lot of hypocrite Christians out there that say they're sinners. Well, you're a sinner or you're a saint. So that tells me there's a lot of lost people in the church that have no evidence of a changed life. They just go on Sundays. A lot of them even go on Wednesdays for Bible studies, but they're not changed. They go to church one or two times a week and then live like Satan the rest of the days of the week. Getting drunk, having sex out of marriage, committing adultery, looking at a woman with lust in your heart, cursing, lying, stealing, saying God's name in vain, all kinds of different things. Worshipping your own God, which could be a girlfriend, a boyfriend, a child, a mother, a car, money. Oh, all kinds of different forms of idolatry out there. But I wanted to read from Romans 3. The caption is All Have Sinned. It's talking about Jews and Greeks or Gentiles, you and me that aren't a Jew. We're all the same. It says, there is none righteous, no, not one. There is none who understands. There is none who seeks after God. True. They have all turned aside. They have together become unprofitable. There is none who does good. No, not one. I'm talking everyone's heart right now. Everyone's conscience. Everyone's conscience knows what's right and wrong. We have that knowledge of good and evil. Says their throat is an open tomb. With their tongues they have practiced deceit. The poison of asps is under their lips. whose mouth is full of cursing and bitterness. This is God's word I'm reading to you. Their feet are swift to shed blood. Destruction and misery are in their ways, and the way of peace they have not known. And then it says, there is no fear of God before their eyes. Fear of God is the beginning of wisdom. Not getting a degree in something in a college or a university. I see more people that are stupid that have degrees than people that have just graduated high school. It's fearing God that gives you wisdom. Reading the Psalms, reading his Proverbs. But like I said, to fear God, that means you do not want to offend him. All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Okay, now that that's said, how are we going to remedy this situation? I'm giving you the answer. I'm living proof. It's not just having somebody stand next to you telling you how to recite a sinner's prayer. Repeat after me. Now you're saved. Come to my church. No. It's feeling a godly sorrow within you. It's allowing the Holy Spirit to condemn your conscience that you've done evil things against the Holy God. But we're all the same. When we do something wrong, what do? We deny it. And if somebody sees us do it, what do? We try to justify it. Even though deep inside you know that you've done wrong, whatever it is, curse God's name. I hear it prevalently. I work for a city, and it's politically correct to say this or to not say that. You can't even mention God's name, but you can curse his name all day long. Well, he will not hold you guiltless for using his name in vain. You don't have to live in that bondage anymore. You can say, thank you, Jesus. You don't have to curse his name anymore. Amen. He knows what I'm talking about. Wake up and be glad that you're alive. You can look at all the things that you used to ignore before, just the simple things in life like the birds and the flowers and all the life around you. Living in this world can be a letdown, I know. Looking at all the filth, looking at all the graffiti, seeing all the hateful people. Seeing all the fighting out there, all the road rage, all the hate, it's awful, and it's getting worse, you all know that. It's not getting any better. All the different things, sense of entitlement that people have, the racism that people have in their hearts, just murderous in God's eyes. Oh, but it's okay to say a white lie, right? Tell them I'm not here. Tell them I'm away, and they're standing right there on the phone. That's okay, right? No. God says it's wrong. If something slips out of your mouth that's untruthful and you're alone, you should repent to God and say, I'm sorry. And if you said something that wasn't truthful to somebody, you should be man or woman enough to go up to them, whether it was your mom or the storekeeper or even a child, and tell them, look, my bad, I'm sorry, I was wrong, I shouldn't have said that, this is right. That's having a fear of God. Why? Because Jesus says,
For every idle word that a man may speak, he will give an account of it on the day of judgment. When is the day of judgment? Well, I'm not talking about the great white throne judgment. The day of judgment's going to happen when you take your last little breath. And if you've died in your sins, you're going to go to heaven and you're going to see your maker, Jesus Christ. But you're not going to be allowed to stay. After the tape of your life is rewound and replayed, you're going to be shaking like a leaf, some of you. You're going to be appalled at the creature that you were. That's why I'm here. You don't have to revel in sin anymore. God can rescue you from sin. He who the Son sets free is free indeed. You can be in right standing with God. The righteousness of Christ can abide in you. This sin state that most of you are in can be rectified, can be changed. I've been changed by the power of the Holy Spirit, and I stand innocent before God. I should have done it longer than 10 years ago. I should have been dead. I always like to use these as examples. You could wind up in one of them. Maybe with no lights, which means you died, and there's a white sheet over you. Right? When they cruise along the streets after they pick the person up, and they're going 25 miles an hour. Gone. It's dead. No coming back. No turn to repent at that time. God's word says, behold, now is the accepted time. Behold, now is the day of salvation. Because tomorrow you might have a heart attack. Tomorrow you might have a stroke, a brain aneurysm. Don't laugh, because it could happen. It happens all the time. I was reading some statistics about LA in 2005 of how many people died in one day. I think it was 165 people died in one day. All kinds of different ways to die. God will crown you with a long life, as it says in the Psalms, if you're His, if you're born again, if you're a saint. But then Jesus says, unless you repent, you will all likewise perish. And there's different ways to go. Building fall on you. A car hit you, car wreck, now you're in ICU with tubes sticking out of you. Trying to keep, yeah, I know you see me. All kinds of different ways of dying. Drug overdose with pharmaceuticals, right? That's prevalent today. Our pusher doctors are giving you all these things that are highly addictive, more addictive than heroin, right? Instead of taking the natural approach with herbs and stuff. I'm not talking about marijuana. That's just another stepping stone to something harder. Right? All these hydroponics and everything. They're not selling just dirt weed over here. They're selling stuff that's crazy now. But weed's no different. I graduated high school, Venice High, on the other side of the tracks. In 83, and I saw, growing up through the 70s, a lot of surfers, a lot of stoners. And what did the weed do to them? It made them stupid. Veg heads. There ain't no difference today. You want to be stupid? You want to be looking at the TV set, right? With the Indian head on there? That the channel has gone blank and you're staring at it? It makes you stupid, okay? Don't tell me, oh, cancer, this and that. There's a lot of other natural stuff out there that's anti-cancer. That's herbal. But you want to smoke and you want to get high. You want to get loaded. You want to get drunk. You want to do what you want to do. Everybody wants to make up their own laws. I hear people say, oh, he's good. Oh, he's a good dude. She's cool. She's good. They could be as wicked as the devil, but they're nice to them, so they're good. They could be cursing God's name, having sex out of marriage, being an adulterer, filthy mouth like an army sergeant. Oh, and they're good. No, no. Let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth, but that which is good, that it may edify you. Good things proceeding out of your mouth. Not bad things. Not poison, like out of a cobra's mouth, just constantly spewing out filthy language, even in front of children. Some of you need to feel bad for what you do. I'm dead serious. Serious as a heart attack. I want to go to chapter 7 of Romans. Read this. It's talking about the Ten Commandments. For we know that the law is spiritual, but I am carnal, sold under sin. This is verse 13 from chapter 7.
What? Ruth?
Amen to that.
No way.
Go home and read it. Don't mock God. Well then, you can get a Bible. For what am I doing? Those that are living in sin. Mocking God. Exhibit A. Here's a perfect example. I do not understand for what I will do. I don't understand why I mock the street preacher. I think I know why, because conscience has been pierced. Again, I'll reiterate it. For what am I doing? I do not understand. For what I will to do, that I do not practice, but that which I hate, that I do. You do the things you don't want to do, even though there's something in your mind that tells you a right thing, but you can't do it. I've been there. But through Jesus Christ, you can do the right thing and be in right standing with God. Anyways, let me continue. If then I do what I will not to do, I agree with the law that it is good. But now, it is no longer I who do it, but sin that dwells in me. It's the sin within you that keeps you in bondage to sin, whatever it is. Smoking cigarettes, which I was delivered in one afternoon. Drugs. There's people that were shooting. They were delivered from heroin. No withdrawals. They even tried to do it later on, some of them. And they couldn't do it. They got sick. And so what am I doing? Once God heals you, it's done. No rehab. The one-step program, Jesus. Praise God. God bless you, sister. God bless you. For I know that in me, that is in my flesh, nothing good dwells. That's why you have to crucify the flesh. For to will is present with me, but how to perform what is good I do not find. For the good that I will to do I do not do, but the evil I will not to do, that I practice. Sound familiar? Now if I do what I will not to do, it is no longer I who do it, but the sin that dwells in me. I find then a law that evil is present within me, that no one who wills to do good. For I delight in the law of God according to my inward man. Oh, and there's some child molester caught. He's going to go to do a life sentence. Oh, good, justice, right? Something happens to one of your relatives. Maybe they were murdered and they catch the murderer. Good, that was good, right? All equates back to the Ten Commandments. That's the sixth commandment, thou shalt not murder. Jesus took it a step further. If you hate your brother, if you have hatred for your brother in your heart, being a racist, you're a murderer. You're going to go to hell. It's not good. You should repent. It says here, but I see another law in my members, warring against the law of my mind, which approves of things that are good, and bringing me into captivity to the law of sin, which is in my members. Can't stop sinning because you're filled with pride. You're filled with a sense of entitlement, right? Some of you are like that. You look down, especially today's white people, they look down on other nationalities. They're filled with hate. They think they're superior when they're not. That's just what I'm finding out there doing evangelism. All the other nationalities are humble and willing to hear God's word, but not today's white people, most of them, unless they're old school. Anyways, enough said with that. It says, oh, wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from this body of death? I thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord. I thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then with the mind I myself serve the law of God, but with the flesh the law of sin. But then it says here in the next chapter, this is important here, there is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. Are you in Christ Jesus? Or am I talking a foreign language to you? Not understanding the things of the Spirit. Who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. That's a saint. Walking according to the Spirit, not to the flesh. Walking according to the flesh will result in death. Death means separation from God. And that means hell. I don't want that for you. There is a heaven and there is a hell. If God can put a burning sphere in the sky called the sun that's on fire 24/7, He can make a lake of fire. You can read about that also, and it's not a parable, the rich man and Lazarus. The rich man went there, and he's still there, under your tires, under the soles of your feet. And Jesus declares that unless you repent, you'll all likewise perish. And Jesus depicts hell as horrifying, the blackness of darkness, where the worm dieth not. The fire's not quenched. There's weeping and wailing and gnashing of teeth. That's where you're going to go unless you repent and become born again. Like God says in John 3 when he told Nicodemus, you must be born again. Born by the Spirit. It's not complicated. Jesus can rescue you. It's like childlike faith. All you have to do is look in the mirror. Look at yourself. The street preacher's right. I have been wicked as all hell, and I need to repent and do it. And when you put one foot in front of the other, you can see Jesus forgive you. When you experience forgiveness and you get a new heart in the mind of Christ, Then you're filled with peace, finally. You don't have to go up the street to take a shot of tequila or drink beer all night long. Or smoke a joint. Or smoke a cigarette for that peace, that false sense of peace. You can have peace. I've experienced that peace. I have that. It's only through God that you can experience peace. Then all these things don't matter. You don't have to, you know, do something like go to the movies every Saturday night, living for your own entertainment, your own self-gratification. Being born again, now you want to serve Christ. You want to lift Him up high, glorify His name. And those are the two commandments. Love God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength. Jesus made 10 into 2. And the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments, hold all the law and the prophets. So it's really not rocket science. It's really easy. But there's going to be a battle when you want to repent. When you finally made it up in your mind, you want to change your mind about the way you've been living, and you want to repent finally, which you can do. There's going to be a battle. Satan's going to fight you tooth and nail with all of his cronies, because he does not want to see you put the cigarette down and stomp it out. He doesn't want to see you pour that half bottle of liquor down the toilet. He doesn't want to see you do that. He doesn't want to see you pick up the Bible. Oh, you know what I'm talking about. Those of you who have Bibles and you can't pick them up. Why is that? Because the devil is there telling you to watch TV, to watch the internet, to do anything else. Call your friends. Anything else but pick up his word. Right? You know what I'm telling you. That's why your Bible lays on the coffee table. Some of your Bibles are like stored away in the garage, under books. Oh, man doesn't live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. This is truth. I'm telling you truth. Concerned about you. You need to be forgiven. You need to experience forgiveness. Not reveling in sin anymore. I'm telling you, Jesus can rescue you from that sin. Dead to sin and alive in Christ. Alive to God. The little gospel tract that I got that I thought was kind of neat. So I'd like to read it to you. It says, life is short. Death is sure. Sin the cause. Christ the cure. But back to the life is short. For what is your life? It is even a vapor that appeareth for a little time and then vanishes away. That verse comes from James 4:14. That's like the self-help book. Then the death is sure. It says this. For those that might believe in reincarnation, I doubt it here. It is appointed unto men once to die, and after this, the judgment. Like I said, judgment happens the day you take your last breath. Sin the cause. Wherefore, as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin, and so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. That goes back to the book I was reading, Romans. This was 5:12. Christ the cure. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Let that echo through your soul. Call on Jesus tonight. Oh, I don't want to see you burn in hell forever. No, I'm concerned about you. You need to see your need for forgiveness and your need for salvation. Come to the Lord before it's too late. Stop being filled with pride and arrogance, self-conceit. Stop living for yourself. Stop looking down on others. Stop hoarding all your money. Help the poor people. Help those that are crippled or blind or weak. I'm not talking about the drunks on the corner with a sign. No, I'm talking about real people that need help. Of course, there might be somebody that needs help from being in bondage to liquor. And Jesus can set them free from that. So I'd encourage you to tell them that. I want to give you, as I always give others, the list of those that are not going to enter into the kingdom of God. Just so that you know it, just so that you hear it firsthand, and just so that you can't say you've never heard it. It says, do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Let's see if you're on this list. Do not be deceived. Neither fornicators, having sex out of marriage, that's you. Top of the list, above homosexuals, fornicators. Nor idolaters. That's somebody putting something above God. Oh, you love your sports team? You love your little cigarettes and cigars and your liquor, your money, your girlfriend, whatever it is? That's idolatry. There's many forms of idolatry. Nor adulterers. Jesus said, he took it a step further, talking to the Pharisees, the religious people, about a letter of divorce. He said, if you look at a woman with lust in your heart, you've already committed adultery. Nor homosexuals. They're going down too. Oh, nor sodomites. You can Wikipedia that later. That's a vile, wicked person there. Nor thieves, irrespective of what he took. It doesn't matter if you stole thousands of dollars or took a dollar or a nickel that fell out of somebody's pocket that didn't belong to you. Thief is a thief is a thief. Nor covetous, that's a materialistic person. Shop until you drop. Nor drunkards, that's somebody that drinks and gets drunk. Not somebody that has a glass of wine with their dinner. It's somebody that drinks to alter the state of their mind. That's a drunkard. Nor revilers. That's a slanderer. Backbiter. Nor extortioners. It's another thief. Will inherit the kingdom of God. None of these people will inherit the kingdom of God. It is what it is. And that's that. And you can't change it. You can't yell at God and tell him, I know I'm your number one preacher, sinner. Let's read God's second hit list. From Revelations 21:8. But the cowardly. I can think of lots of different cowards. Child molester comes right to mind. Unbelieving, that's an atheist. Abominable, that's someone that's disgusting and loathsome, vile. Murderers, sexually immoral, there it is again. Better stop watching pornography. Pray to God for forgiveness and read his Bible instead. Basic instruction before leaving this earth. Sorcerers, like today's drug addicts, those are sorcerers, just another form of sorcery. witchcraft, idolaters, I already explained that, and all liars shall have their part in the lake which burns with fire and brimstone, which is the second death.
Stop.
Praise God. God bless you, sister. That's the second death. Here's how it goes. You die in your sins. I don't want this to happen, but it's a scenario. Die in your sins. You lift up your eyes in torment in the world of the dead, down there. Unimaginable torment. You can read about the rich man and Lazarus, like I said before. Then you're there for many, 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 many eons of years. Those that died in their sins, you'll be with those people that died in Sodom and Gomorrah that were destroyed. All the wicked people will be with you. And then there'll be a great white throne judgment, a resurrection. And then you'll be condemned and thrown, bound hand and foot by an angel, and cast into the lake of fire. And you'll be there for all eternity with the devil. This is serious, people. It's serious. It's so serious, God would have me stand on a street corner and preach his gospel to you. Oh, and it doesn't matter how old you are. Youth is no guarantee for old age. Oh, you say you got your whole life ahead of you, but people 14, 15, 17 die all of a sudden. And they're past the age of accountability, which is 13 for a boy, 12 for a girl. You know better. Well, hopefully you do. Now I'm going to read the gospel to you that Paul wrote to the Corinthian church, the letter that he wrote. It says, "Moreover, brethren, I declare to you the gospel, which is the good news, which I preach to you, which also you received, and in which you stand, by which also you are saved, if you hold fast to that word which I preached to you, unless you believed in vain or for nothing." Some of you have believed for nothing. Some of you confess with your mouth, but don't believe in your heart. If I ask most of the people out here, other than the atheists who are ignorant, most of them would say they love God. Oh yeah? Well, prove it. Live for God if you love God. Talk is cheap. Put one foot in front of the other, and if your friends reject you, say goodbye, because I'm serving Christ now. I'm through with this lifestyle I've been living with the world, going out with you, sleeping with you, whatever it is you're doing with your friends, smoking dope with your friends, cussing like a sailor. Goodbye. I'm serving Christ. And if you want to persecute me, go right ahead. Let me continue on now. It says, "For I delivered to you first of all that which I also received," because he was saved on the road to Damascus, "that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures." That's been established. Right? "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, and whosoever should believe in him should have everlasting life." That's already been established. We know that. "And that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the scriptures, and that he was seen by Cephas," that's Peter in the Greek, "then by the 12 disciples. After that he was seen by over 500 brethren at once," the resurrected Christ. "Oh, they killed me, but here I am, alive and alive forevermore." Can't kill God. But he died in his body, shed his blood for you. Without the shedding of blood, there's no forgiveness of sins. That's why he shed his blood for you, because only blood purifies sins. And only God's blood takes sin away, washes it as white as snow, separates it as far as the east is from the west, to be remembered no more. That's why people get excited when they get saved, because they know that their sins have been forgiven. And then you have God's peace in you. Said then last of all, he was seen by me, that's Paul, also, as one by one born out of due time. Paul says, I am the least of the apostles, who am not worthy to be called an apostle because I persecuted the church of God. Amen. Yeah, Paul persecuted believers and then came back and wrote 1 Corinthians 13, the chapter on love. That's awesome. You ever read that? Oh, I know. Your version of love might be, I don't know, giving your parents a gift or something and saying you love them. No, no, no. Read Paul's depiction of love. Deep, godly love. Make the little hairs on your arm stand up. It's beautiful. So turn to the living God, repent of your sin. That means having a change of mind about where you're going and what you're doing. Cry out to God, cry to Jesus, and He will wash you clean. He'll forgive you. You can be in right standing with God. One other thing I wanted to talk about was in the book of Galatians, Paul's letter to the Galatian church, about the spirit and the flesh. It says, I say then, walk in the spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Here's what the flesh is. For the flesh lusts against the spirit, and the spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary to one another, so that you do not do the things that you wish. But if you are led by the Spirit, God's Spirit, you are not under the law. You can listen to this. See if this describes some of your character. The works of the flesh are evident, which are adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lewdness, idolatry, sorcery, hatred, contentions, jealousies, outbursts of wrath, selfish ambitions, dissensions, heresies, envy, murders, drunkenness, revelries, and the like of which I tell you beforehand, just as I told you in the time past, that those who practice such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, which is patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such these there is no law. And those who are Christ's have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. If we live in the Spirit, let us all walk in the Spirit. Let us not become conceited, provoking one another, envying one another.
teach. Now every man must work out his own soul salvation. But when the children of God get together, the sure water of the nation, tell you that God don't want it and you don't want it. You don't need it.
This concludes this outreach in Whittier. It's an old town outside mall. I forget the name of this this area. Maybe I can ask somebody. At any rate, I'll find out later what it is and write it in the captions. So, praise God. God bless you. You need Jesus.